GLP-1 weight loss drugs, how safe are they? Regulatory authorities have expressed concerns about the potential risk of acute pancreatitis, thyroid cancer, and kidney failure, warnings that are appropriately conveyed in every box of drugs handed to a patient. Here's the actual package insert for high-dose Ozempic, sold for weight loss as Wegovy. Warnings and precautions include thyroid tumors, acute inflammation of the pancreas, acute gallbladder disease, heightened risk of low blood sugars if you're on blood sugar-lowering medications, acute kidney injury, allergic reactions, worsening eye disease for those with type 2 diabetes, an increase in heart rate that should be monitored, and suicidal thoughts and behaviors. And the package insert for the other major GLP-1 weight loss drug, tirzepatide, sold as Zepbound, reads almost word for word the same. Let's start with the good news. Suicide. The possibility of an adverse psychiatric event on GLP-1 drugs is biologically plausible because GLP-1 receptors are widely expressed in the central nervous system, including our brain. So what does the science show? This meta-analysis of randomized controlled trials did not highlight any detrimental effect on these drugs on mental health, including suicide. Now, this meta-analysis only covered studies up through the end of 2023, and only clinical trials, and those with mental illnesses are usually excluded from such studies. But there have been newer studies done with subjects out in the real world, and again, no clear increased risk. And this study on the association of the Ozempic drug semaglutide with risk of suicidal ideation in another cohort found that the drug was associated with a lower risk for incident and recurrent suicidal ideation, apparently cutting suicidal thoughts by more than half compared to those on the older, less effective weight loss drugs. After all, a weight-reducing treatment that limits the burden of obesity could improve mood. I told you suicide was the good news. Now on to cancer. Both Wegovy, high-dose Ozempic, and Zepbound, tirzepatide, carry so-called black box warnings for thyroid cancer risk. Black box warnings are the U.S. Food and Drug Administration's strictest caution about potentially life-threatening hazards. In rodents, these drugs cause dose-dependent and duration-dependent thyroid tumors at clinically relevant exposures, meaning the kind of doses prescribed to humans. Now, we don't know yet whether these drugs cause a thyroid cancer called medullary thyroid carcinoma, which is a cancer of the thyroid C cells in humans. To be on the safe side, the drugs shouldn't be prescribed for high-risk individuals like those with a personal or family history of thyroid cancer, but it's not like the rats had thyroid cancer running in their families. Doctors should counsel their patients to remain alert for symptoms of thyroid tumors, like a lump or swelling in the neck, trouble swallowing, shortness of breath, or persistent hoarseness. I'd be curious in the comments to see if any viewers who've been prescribed these drugs were told any of this by their prescribing physicians. Can't we just ultrasound people's necks to see if they develop thyroid tumors on these drugs? That's considered to be of uncertain value, since no such studies have been done. Now, there have been studies done on GLP-1 drugs like Ozempic and the risk of thyroid cancer in people. This was the first major one raising concern, published in 2023. Researchers found increased risk of all thyroid cancers, and specifically medullary thyroid cancer, in people using these drugs, particularly after taking them for a few years. A commentary citing the study asked, "Is it the time to be concerned? Maybe that one study was just a fluke." No. After putting together all the best studies, a systematic review and meta-analysis of randomized controlled trials found, again, a significant increase in the risk of overall thyroid cancer, about 52% greater odds. That sounds bad until you realize just how rare the cancer is overall. The incidence of thyroid cancer in this kind of population is 0.285 cases per 1,000 patient years. This means that over a span of 10 years, we'd only expect about 3 people out of 1,000 to get that cancer. So even if you bump up that risk by 50%, you're still only talking about 4 in 1,000 getting it over a decade, compared to 3 in 1,000 if you hadn't started taking the drugs. That translates to a 5-year number needed to harm of 1,349. That means that even if this were truly cause and effect, it would take treating 1,349 people for 5 years to cause a single additional case of thyroid cancer. And even if you're the unlucky soul who gets it, it's pretty mild as cancers go. The 5-year relative survival rate, meaning the likelihood you'll still be alive 5 years after diagnosis compared to people without the cancer, is 98.4%. OK, but what about the risk of pancreatic cancer with the use of these drugs? That has a relative 5-year survival rate of only 12.8%. You can see the difference between the incidence rates and the death rates. For thyroid cancer, a bunch of people are diagnosed with it, but very few die from it. Whereas for pancreatic cancer, almost everyone who gets it dies from it. So, do these drugs cause pancreatic cancer? That's exactly the question I'll address next.